eternally grateful. Oh, Lord, I pray that everything we do here today will bring you honor and glory. Lord, I thank you for the two that have come to faith in Jesus Christ in the last week. I pray that you bring many more to your glory and honor. Lord, I pray that you would anoint and bless this message today, that we would not only learn things, but that we would be changed ourselves and be more discerning and more careful about false teachers. Lord, I pray that you would heal those among us who need healing. Father, we all have something wrong with us, be it emotional, mental, or physical. I pray for healing. I pray your mighty right hand would descend upon those who are ailing and bring them to health. Lord, I pray for those who are struggling financially or in bad marriages or whatever the case may be. I pray, Father, that you bring the peace that passes all understanding for those people. I pray for the lonely. I pray for those who have lost loved ones. Mercy and grace and peace. And I pray that this message, Lord, would bring you glory and honor. Make us more like your Son and save those among us who are lost. In Jesus' precious name, amen. All right, you can have a seat. Welcome. It's good to see you all. And it's good to see the sunshine and the trees not blowing over. Really good. But there's another one coming Wednesday, I guess, or Tuesday. Oh, boy. Karen and I will be on vacation starting Thursday, getting away from here for a month to the south, God's country. And I have some interesting and I think will be very effective guest preachers for while I'm gone. Some of you know Dave Mumford. He'll be here next Sunday. He won't be performing, but he'll be preaching. And then there's two Sundays when Dr. Emery will be here. And I know a lot of the old-timers remember him when he was the interim pastor here. I don't mean old in age. I mean people have been here for a long time. Oh. So, and then there's another fellow. I doubt you've heard of him, but I would let that be a surprise. We do have our live streaming back up, working again. So I'm once again a televangelist, I guess. No, I'm not. I'm going to talk about them today. I want to remind you that we've got a well-stocked library here of theological material, and don't let that word scare you. There's a lot of good books in there about the Christian life. Just if you got questions or problems or anything, there's some good authors that have written some good books. There's some biographies of well-known Christians that are always interesting to read, and it will help you. This library can help you with your Bible study. And the women are going to continue to meet on Thursdays at 11 o'clock. They're studying a book on women of the Bible. And from what I'm hearing, because my wife's involved in it, it's been very informative, very interesting. And I just think you'd enjoy it. So are there any other announcements that anybody knows of? That we got a little wind damage out here. I guess you probably saw the bench blocking the drive-thru. Hopefully somebody will get that wire put back up in there pretty soon. So you all know that I was preaching through the last several months, been preaching through the book of Genesis, and then Christmas came. So we did 4 weeks of Christmas sermons, and then I had 3 Sundays I had to fill before I go on vacation. I didn't want to start back on Genesis again and then be gone for a month and then get back to it. So I've been kind of doing some fill-in stuff, and I thought about this week after watching something on TV that, you know, we could probably use a little help identifying false teachers because they're everywhere. And so I'm going to go through what is almost a lecture versus a sermon, but it's kind of a both. But it's very informative. It was for me, as I went through and developed the material, that I didn't even realize how evil these false teachers can be. So I'm going to give you some of the most common false teachings to start off with in the Christian religion. There's a lot of them, but these are five big ones. Every Christian can and should speak in tongues and needs to in order to be saved. The Bible teaches that salvation comes through faith in Jesus Christ alone, not through speaking tongues. Second, Christians can lose their salvation. That's heresy, just absolute heresy. It is God's will that every Christian be healthy and wealthy. How many of you are rich? Jesus' death on the cross is for salvation from sins, not deliverance from worldly peril. Countless faithful Christians have suffered and continue to suffer poverty and sickness. Number four, Christians, actually there's seven of these. I said there was five, didn't I? Christians can claim, decree, or speak something into existence. This is a misreading of Romans 4:17. Humans do not have the power to manipulate God merely by speaking. Even when we pray fervently, he is sovereign and his hand is not forced. Number five, legalism. This is the idea that a lot of rules and regulations and following them closely will please God. Legalism says things like, real Christians don't have tattoos. Real Christians never miss a church service. Number six, hyper grace. This is the idea that because we're saved, we can do whatever we want and God's okay with it. It's also called antinomianism. This is an abuse of the freedom God has given us in Christ. And number seven, hell is not real. And God is too good to send anybody there. Jesus speaks about hell, as does the closing chapters of Revelation. Some other false beliefs. Oh, there's a bunch of them. When you start digging into it, you find out how much is out there. Follow your heart. Do not follow your heart. Calvin said that the heart is the factory of all sorts of wickedness. Now, I don't mean the organ, the heart. Don't go by your feelings. Godly living brings prosperity. Both of my grandmothers were probably the godliest women I've ever met, and they didn't own a thing. Right choices will get you the perfect life. Is there such thing as a perfect life? I don't think so. But we should be satisfied in life. There's nothing wrong with that. Next, I hate this one. God will never give you more than you can handle. Yes, he will. What he'll do is he'll give you the ability to handle it. I hear people say this all the time. Well, God won't give you more than you can handle. He does it to me all the time. But there's a reason for it. It's not just him being mean. If you try harder, you can be right with God. You're only right with God in Christ. Or to say, I deserve better. No, what you and I deserve is hell. But his mercy has delivered us from that. And then the height of narcissism, I think. I need me time. Now, there's nothing wrong with wanting time to yourself. I do it all the time. But it's not because I'm worshiping at the idol of Russ Fletcher. Sometimes you just need to be alone. So let's put this in context. The New Testament letter writers, Paul, Peter, John, those guys, were highly and rightfully concerned with the false teachers in the early church. It seems as if Satan unloaded both barrels on the church with the aim of destroying or diluting or twisting the true doctrines of the faith handed down by Jesus and the apostles. The two most common false teachings in the early church were Judaizing and Gnosticism. Judaizing was the belief that Christians had to follow all the laws and traditions of the Old Testament. In other words, you could not be a Christian and not be a Jew, first and foremost. These false teachers demanded that all Christian men be circumcised, that all should follow Jewish dietary laws as well as all the feasts and ceremonies of the Jews. Gnosticism was a widespread false teaching in the first few centuries of the church. It believed there was a lesser God, what they called a demiurge, under our God. They also believed that man's highest goal should be the attainment of ultimate knowledge. They had a lot of other weird beliefs I don't want to get into, but the early church fathers saw in Gnosticism something that was just completely opposed to Christianity. So keep in mind, as we go through this, talking about the early church, once it began to spread over the known world, it was surrounded by pagan religions. These beliefs usually involved some kind of sick sexual immorality as a form of worship, and the worship of multitudes of pagan gods. Some of them even involved child sacrifice. Outside of Israel, most believers, new believers, had been practitioners of the pagan religions. So I don't have a single text. I don't have a single text for this. I got a whole bunch of them because it's talked about a lot in mainly the New Testament. So I'm not going to ask you to turn to these scriptures. I just want you to listen to them and see that what I tell you is backed up by scripture. It always should be anyway, right? So the main idea of this lesson, sermon, whatever you want to call it, is the Church of Jesus Christ should always be on alert for false teachings and false teachers. Not much has changed. Here's the historical context of how we can relate to this. There were false teachers in the ancient church just as there are now. Watch just about any TV preacher, and odds are he's a false teacher, a fraud. Sadly, some of them seem quite legitimate on the surface. So we need to be able to discern between the bad ones and the good ones. And they're not just on TV. Some are quite good at slipping into a church and pushing their demonic teachings. Demonic, I'm using that word on purpose. We must be aware of them and call them out. You agree? So the first thing I did, after getting a drink of water, is I looked in the scriptures, mainly in the New Testament, where false teachers were specifically described, very clearly described. And I want to quote some of this to you. In 1 Timothy chapter 3, they taught different doctrines. They are devoted to myths and genealogies, because genealogies gave you status in certain cultures. They loved not from a pure heart, and they wandered into vain discussions. They were very legalistic, and they do not understand God's word. In 1 Timothy 6, they taught different doctrines than what Jesus' words were. They were ungodly, conceited. They craved controversy. You know people like that? They quarreled about words. They stirred up envy, dissension, slander, evil suspicions, constant friction among the ungodly. They pursued godliness for gain, desiring riches, senseless and harmful desires. They were unrighteous, to say the least, ungodly, faithless, loveless, unsteady, and coarse. These are all right from the Bible. 2 Peter chapter 2, they secretly bring in destructive heresies to the church. Heresies means a false doctrine, false belief. They denied Jesus as master. They were sensual and blasphemous of the truth, greedy liars, lusting after defiling passions, despising authority except their own. They were bold and willful, creatures of instinct, behaving like irrational animals. I mean, the Bible doesn't pull any punches when he's describing these people. Ignorant, reveling in their deceptions, adulterous, an insatiable desire to sin, and they're good at enticing unsteady souls. They speak loud and boast of folly. They boast of what they do. They entice others by sensual passions of the flesh. Slaves to corruption. The book of Jude says they pervert the grace of God into sensuality. They deny Christ. They're defilers of the flesh. They reject authority. No fear of God. They're shameful. They're grumblers and malcontents. They follow sinful desires. They loudmouth. They show favoritism for gain. Scoffers. They cause divisions. Worldly and devoid of the Holy Spirit. Are we done yet? In Colossians, they follow strict man-made rules. They focus on earthly things, not heavenly things. 1 John, they deny the full humanity and full divinity of Jesus Christ. They're devoid of joy, unholy, and unloving. Yeah, the Bible really does have a lot to say about these guys. In 2 John, inhospitable. They take advantage of others. They're unkind. They're destroyers of faith. They're disobedient. 3 John, they refuse to help needy believers. They're slanderers. They oppose those who disagree with them. Prideful, not living by God's word, unloving, not discerning. In Jeremiah 28, they are purveyors of false prophecies and predictions, and they are rebellious to the Lord. In the book of Acts, false teachers oppose genuine men of God. They're villainous and they twist God's word around. Revelation 16 describes them as demonic, warring against God and his people. And finally, Revelation 19, what is their fate? They're destined for the lake of fire. I didn't realize I had that much until I got up here and started saying it. So, how do we identify these people? Sometimes you know them when you see them, right? You just know them. You don't have to hear very much come out of their mouths. You just identify them as a false teacher. But it's not always that easy. And this is something that every church needs to keep in mind, especially when they're hiring a new pastor or hiring new staff. First, I've got 8 ways to spot false teachers. I give credit to Crossway Online for giving me much of this. False teaching preys on the spiritually immature. Listen to this in Ephesians 4. And he, God, gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we may no longer be children tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness and deceitful schemes. Rather, speak the truth in love. We are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ. This is why we make disciples. You don't make a disciple by leading someone to Christ. You have to then take that person and teach them. And this is why, you know I'm not a legalist, but this is why it's important for you to be here in church Sunday morning and Wednesday night. Because you're going to learn. You're going to learn from the book about our Savior. And you need to do study. ungodly ambition, ignorance, and conceit. If anyone teaches a different doctrine, 1 Timothy 6, and does not agree with the sound words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and a teaching that accords with godliness, he is puffed up with conceit and understands nothing. He has an unhealthy craving for controversy and for quarrels about words which produce envy, dissension, slander, evil, and suspicions. And I read the rest of it earlier. Now, I don't know why a person would go into the pastorate thinking they could get rich. I don't know. I've never known a pastor, a real pastor, who lived in a big, fancy house. Mostly, they get very modest salaries. Now, you get into the megachurch world, and that's a whole different ballgame. Some of these boys have got mansions. And there's nothing wrong with that. But we're talking about ambition and conceit here. It's not all about you, preacher. It's about the one you speak of. And you should be satisfied with whatever humble lodgings or anything else he gives you. There was a little town where I had my business outside Atlanta. There were three or four mainly African-American churches. And I never went in them, but I used to drive by them all the time, going to lunch or whatever. And about every 2 years, I would see a brand spanking new Mercedes or BMW parked in front of the church every day. So I'm assuming that was the pastor's car. These people were buying their pastor, at the time, $40,000, $50,000, $60,000 cars every couple of years. They wanted their pastor to look good when he drove around town. Don't you try that with me. I don't like those cars. I've driven them all. I don't like them. I'd rather have my truck. Ungodly ambition, ignorance, and conceit. I'm going to talk more about ignorance in just a minute. False teaching sometimes stems from a desire for material gain. Again, I don't know why a man would go into the pastorate expecting to get rich. But read this, 1 Timothy 6, for the love of money is a root of all kinds of evils. Not money. It's the love of money. It is through this craving that some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pangs. Number five, false teaching can result from and lead to inappropriate sensuality and sexual immorality. You've heard the stories. Pastors and church staff molesting children, raping women, having affairs. Listen to this in 2 Timothy chapter 3, 4. For the time is coming. This is a prediction. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching. Ring a bell? But having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions. And they're out there. And will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. Number six, false teaching is sometimes attributed to demonic deception. 1 Timothy 4. Now the Spirit expressly says that in later times, some will depart from the faith by devoting themselves to deceitful spirits and the teachings of demons. This is all in the Bible. Through the insincerity of liars whose consciences are seared. Number seven, false teachers seek to divide the body of Christ. Romans 16, Paul writes, I appeal to you, brothers, to watch out for those who cause division and create obstacles contrary to the doctrine that you have been taught. Avoid them, for such persons do not serve our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own appetites. And by smooth talk and flattery, they deceive the hearts of the naive. Bible pretty well covers this stuff, doesn't it? The last one, false teaching can come from apostates and deviant teachers within the church. An apostate is someone who's wandered from the faith, but they're still pretending to be a believer. 2 Peter 2, another prediction, you guys. But false prophets also arose among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you, who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the master who bought them, bringing upon themselves swift destruction. And many will follow their sensuality, and because of them the way of truth will be blasphemed. And in their greed they will exploit you with false words. Their condemnation from long ago is not idle, and their destruction is not asleep. So many so-called Christians have, and real Christians, have fallen victim to false teachers. There are other false teachings, just real quick. I'm not going to go into detail. Easy believism. Well, I walked down the aisle, filled out a card, and shook the pastor's hand, so I'm saved. Not if there hasn't been transformation in your life. Then there's legalism. We've already kind of discussed that. Guys, you can't have long hair. Girls, you can't wear pants. These are actual teachings in some churches. Cheap grace. That means not valuing the grace of God enormously in your life. Perfectionism. Some people believe now that they're Christians, they can't sin anymore. Would it surprise you that your pastor sins every day? Because I'm human still. Salvation through the sacraments. Some people believe that you have to go through the waters of baptism, the Lord's Supper, and some churches add more sacraments to it. And those are what save you. No. And in no wise are we going to follow the doctrine that says give your heart to Jesus. I know that's a common phrase we use in our circles. And what we mean when we say it usually is just that I got saved. But listen, Jesus doesn't want your heart. What does he want? All of you. Then there's a belief out there that Jesus is not God. He was just a great teacher, great man. Then there's a prosperity gospel. I'm going to talk about those bozos here in a minute. Is it okay for me to say that word in the pulpit? I've said worse. So I hope, and I'm almost done, believe it or not. You're going to get out of here early today. I hope we have learned from today's message that there are many false teachers and teachings that lurk everywhere. In some churches, in some seminaries, online. Don't believe anything you see online. TV and Bible colleges included, some of them. We have constantly got to be on guard and depend on Scripture alone to formulate our doctrines, which tell us how to correctly believe. And just because you've always believed something and have always been taught something doesn't necessarily mean it's correct. What is correct? Biblical. Okay? Delve into Scripture yourself. Attend Bible studies. Talk with your pastor if he's a trusted man of God. If you're ever looking for a new church, and I hope none of you do that, but this is important. Go to one where the preacher mainly uses expository preaching. That means that he preaches the Word of God by exposing the meaning of the sermon text as it was originally intended to be understood by the original authors and the original audience. It takes work for the trusted preacher to put together a sermon that is accurate to the Scriptures. If a pastor throws together a sermon on Saturday night, it's probably lacking in depth and accuracy. I knew a pastor that made it a regular practice, a good friend of mine. He'd wait till Friday or Saturday night, and he'd throw something together. His sermons were always entertaining, but that was it. The proper sermon takes days and sometimes longer to create. I want to especially warn you about TV preachers, most of them anyway. The vast majority of them are involved in the health, wealth, and prosperity gospel. Pure heretics. Don't even listen to one word out of their mouths. And certainly don't send them any money. They will tell you to give a seed faith gift of some odd amount of money, and you will reap a harvest from God. Perhaps wealth, good health, stronger faith, or something that you cannot buy. I get a kick. I go over to Mom's house every morning with the dogs. You know, she fixes breakfast for me. We watch Gunsmoke. But on Saturdays, Gunsmoke's not on. It's camp meeting. Now, we don't watch it. But once in a while, I'll turn to it. We get a big laugh, don't we, Mom? Nobody on that show can sing. But the preachers, that is who I'm talking about right here. And this Saturday, they had a thing up there. Send $58 as your seed faith. Why $58? Why not 50? Because they're trying to give the impression that the Holy Spirit has given this amount to them to say, you need to give. Here's the thing that sickens me, and it really does make me angry. These guys are still on the air because people send them money. Because they have itching ears. They have not been taught Scripture, or they've been taught wrong from Scripture. They are naive. What's the other word? These are the people that the scammers go after. Okay? If that makes any sense to you. They don't think for themselves. Just because somebody is a good speaker doesn't mean that the words that fall from their mouth are true. Then, speaking of money, I never talk about money in here, but I got to say this. If your pastor is always asking for tithes and offerings, you might want to change churches. God will provide whatever funding is needed for a ministry that trusts and relies on Him. In 7 years of preaching here, it's really been that long. I have not preached a single sermon on giving or tithing or even money. I have never begged you folks for money. And you know God has richly provided more than we could ever hope to have. Read the biography of George Mueller. Mueller, it's a German name. And you'll see. He's the guy who started all the orphanages in England back in the 1800s. And he didn't have a penny. And he just prayed every day, Lord, give us what we need for today. Guess what? The kids in that orphanage never missed a meal. Sometimes somebody would show up on the door and they're all sitting at the dining room table with empty plates and they had just the amount of food for the orphans given to them, just out of the blue. God always provided and God will always provide what you need. And to some, He might give more than they need. That's God's choice. All right, so this is another warning. I'm just full of warnings here today. Don't rely on just any internet source to help you determine if a teacher or a teaching is true or false. There are some reliable websites, but many are posted by false teachers themselves. And will have you believe that some perfectly biblical and accurate doctrines are false. But be very careful. Rely on this, your pastor and reliable Bible scholars, to help you weed out the lies. And there's a lot of them out there. Now, some of you are probably thinking, because I would be, but Pastor, there's some Bible teachings that are difficult to understand for the average layperson. And you'd be right. This is one reason why training, experience, and education of your pastor is so important. Ideally, he should have a Master of Divinity degree from a reputable evangelical seminary. This is not an absolute requirement. It's ideal. Because getting that degree, that pastor has been trained in the original Bible languages and in how to interpret accurately for modern minds the scriptures. But this is not a substitute for your own personal study. This is why we now have a theological library, give you the resources you need. Anytime you want to go in there, you can contact one of us. We'll find a way to get you in there, because we're not open here every day. But on Wednesdays, it's wide open. This thing, we did this to help you in your faith, growing in your faith, knowledge, and wisdom. Because not everybody has a theological library in their house. In your own Bible study time, take notes about passages that you don't understand. And then use the library to find answers. Do you know personal research into these things is more effective for you than asking someone else to help you understand? You've got to do the hard work yourself. Okay? So why is this so important? Because we need to know what we believe and why we believe it. Do you know why, for example, it is absolutely essential that Jesus of Nazareth was born of a virgin? That's an essential doctrine in the Christian faith. If you don't believe that, you're not a Christian. The reason is, she was impregnated by God. And she had to be pure, and Jesus had to be born pure, because he ended up being the perfect sacrifice with no blemish, no stain of the sinful nature of man. That's why it's essential. If we deny the virgin birth, then we're denying that Jesus was God. He was just a great teacher, right? Wrong. So we need to know what we believe and why accurately. And also, knowing the truth of Scripture better equips us to share the gospel with other people. If you're confident in what you believe, you'll be confident in witnessing. You know, if the time left to us is short, because Jesus is coming back soon, we got a lot of work to do. Think of all your unsaved relatives, friends, co-workers, neighbors. The more you are well-versed in the Christian faith, the better able you will be to lead others to Jesus. We're having a baptism when I get back from vacation. Last Sunday, I led Danny and Chris to Christ, and they want to be a part of our church. This is something we've got to celebrate, guys. You don't have to say anything or stand up, but it's a huge deal. You are now citizens of the kingdom of heaven. And this is what we're talking about, folks. The time may be short. We already got our ticket stamped, most of us. Okay, we're going to heaven. But we are not to sit back and wait for Jesus to grab us. We are to work. We are to tell others. Let me tell you what this story is all about. It's about you being a sinner. Me too. We are all sinners. The Bible says there is no one righteous. We were born with a sin nature. That doesn't necessarily make us bad, evil people. It just means that we don't know God, we choose not to know God, and we choose to do things we know that are disobedient to God. We couldn't fix ourselves either. Most of us in this room can tell you that we've tried to fix ourselves. And how well has that worked for us? Not always good results. And there is nothing that you can do to get your relationship with God repaired. Nothing you can do. You can't give the church enough money. You can't do enough good deeds, good works, service in the community, volunteering to help others. Those are all great things, but they don't get you into heaven. God saw that, and he said, I love these people. Now that blows my mind. Just stop right there. Because if I was God, I would have nuked me a long time ago. But there's a thing called grace, guys. God created us to be in relationship with Him, and we blew it at the Garden of Eden. We blew it, and we continue to blow it. So He said, I'm going to send my Son. I'm going to make Him the perfect sacrifice. And He will die on a cross, terrible agony and suffering. And while He's dying on that cross, God said, I'm going to put the punishment of all the sins of these people on Him. The punishment that I deserve was put on Jesus. Now, the punishment is hell. So Jesus basically had hell poured out on Him on that cross. When He did that, He made a decree that whoever will believe in my Son, that He is my Son, and that He died on a cross for their sins will be forgiven, past, present, and future. And they will spend eternity with me in heaven. Back to the relationship we were intended to have, right? Now, our faith is not sight yet. We're still in this fallen world. We're still in these bodies that are corruptible. One day, either He will come back and take us to heaven and give us our new bodies, or we will die, get buried. Our spirits will go to be with Him, and when He returns to this earth, we'll get our new bodies. Either way, I'm getting a new body, y'all. Anything would be an improvement. But it's going to be incorruptible. That means it's immortal. It'll never die. It'll never suffer again. Listen to me. Y'all get sick and tired of watching the news. Stop watching it, by the way. But when you watch it, it makes you upset, doesn't it? All the crime. Yeah, I'm from Atlanta, and I got an app on my phone for the local news station down there. And I look at it every day just to see what's going on in my hometown, you know. Oh, Lord. I would never move back there. The crime, the murders, the craziness. And it's in all the cities. We're fortunate that it hasn't hit us with any force here. There's crazies around, but listen to me. Nobody loves living in a world in that condition. But there will be one. I told Sunday school class, this is why I close with this. I was listening to this song on Pandora, name of the song was Almost Home. We're almost home. Some of you may have heard it. It's great. I said, Karen, yeah, I got a new take on getting old. The older we get, the closer to home we get. So bring on 70. Bring on 80. I don't care. Closer to home. Most of us in here are older folks. And you know, it's true. When you get up in your 60s or 70s, you start thinking about mortality. Because you know you've lived two-thirds or three-quarters of your life already. Why would someone not go to Christ? It's not going to fix all your problems. Life's still going to be tough. It might even get tougher. Because you see with new eyes, spiritual eyes, you'll see the actual evil that saturates this world that you're blind to right now. But you'll know you have that blessed hope. You'll be almost home. And then tomorrow, you'll be almost home some more. The day after that, you'll be almost home some more. It makes me think about why are we also negative about getting old? I know the aches and pains and the health and all that. But you know what? Who cares? No, I don't care. I'm going to get a new body. And God's going to take care of me and give me everything I need to survive as He will you. If you come to Him and you place your faith, the Bible says, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. Somebody tell me what's complicated about that. Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved. Believe means to not just believe that He existed. It means to willingly follow Him as His disciple. Believe that He saved you. And here's the beauty. This is the thing that blows my mind all the time. When you put your faith in Christ, not only does He already put your punishment for your sins on Jesus. Now he has assigned to you and me the righteousness of Jesus. What that means is, in a judicial sense, God looks upon us, and he sees all, and he doesn't see our filthiness. Hallelujah. What he sees is Jesus' righteousness. We are condemned no longer. He will say to you and me one day, enter into the joy that's been prepared for you. How about that? Why do Christians fear death? Funny thing about it, in the South, there is like this culture of where you don't even say the word dead. You just don't talk about it. It's just not talked about in good company, okay? Much less joked about, even in a church. Listen to me. If you're a Christian here today, death is a portal that will open up and bring you into indescribable glory and joy. And I know what you're thinking. What you fear is the process of dying. Listen, don't worry about that either. If God's taking you home, you can put up with anything. All right? But if you don't know Christ, death is final. There is no such thing as annihilationism, which some people believe when we die, we just cease to exist. Everybody lives forever, just not everyone in heaven. All right, you feel like you can identify a false teacher now? I guess we have a closing song here. And I meant to tell you earlier...